Ladies and gentlemen, excellencies, colleagues and esteemed guests from abroad, dear friends of the Norwegian Helsinki Committee, a warm welcome to our 40th anniversary. My name is Bjørn Engesland and I'm the Secretary General of the Norwegian Helsinki Committee. Today we celebrate 40 years of struggle to promote human rights, fundamental freedoms, rule of law, and democratic governance throughout Europe and in Central Asia. This struggle is reflected in our exhibition outside the City Hall this week. We are proud that His Royal Highness the Crown Prince of Norway was present at the opening of the exhibition on Monday. The exhibition presents 40 years of continuous work to promote human rights through portraits of 14 courageous women and men. In 1977, a group of activists from across the political spectrum established the Norwegian Helsinki Committee. The aim was to support persecuted human rights defenders in Europe. The first mission went to Moscow, where they met with Nobel Peace Prize laureate Andrei Sakharov. The Cold War seemed endless and Europe had been divided for decades. The struggle for human rights seemed a hopeful, if not naive, project to engage in. 40 years later, the project appears less naive, but unfortunately just as relevant. Today we have arrived at the situation that in many ways are a repetition of the challenges of the 70s and the Cold War confrontation. The main task of the Norwegian Helsinki Committee is once again to support human rights activists in Europe and the former Soviet republics. An important difference is though that there are many more activists to support today. And I appreciate that many of our partners are here around us this evening. The Norwegian Helsinki Committee is a child of the Helsinki Final Act, the security treaty that lives on as the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, the OSCE. Armed with the Helsinki Final Act, activists from across Europe came together and demanded change. The effects of the democratic surge that brought down the Berlin Wall, swept through Europe and around the world, are still felt today. The struggle to ensure basic rights for all is by no means over. In some countries, the use of torture is systematic and widespread. Journalists are still being imprisoned. Being critical of certain regimes can mean exposing yourself and your family to harm. Many people have never participated in a free election. The right to freely and fully exercise your religion or belief of choice is not something you can take for granted in many countries. Sexual minorities face attacks while police provide little, if any, protection. The revolution of 1989 was not all about human rights, of course. The 1986 fall in the oil price proved disastrous for the vulnerable Soviet economy. But no one should neglect or forget what has been labeled the Helsinki effect. International solidarity and civic courage created history. It was around this time that I myself became part of the Norwegian Helsinki Committee, first as a member, then a board member, and later on as the Secretary General. It is not possible to mention all the people who have dedicated themselves to the human rights cause by working for the committee. But one great source of strength is that we are a diverse group. About half of our staff has foreign origin. This gives the organization competence in foreign languages, political cultures, and strengthens our relationship with our partners. The other half is not less important. highly educated and engaged persons who gives a large part of their energy and time to the cause of human rights. All of them have contributed and made the committee to what it is today. History did not end in the 90s. Seen from a Norwegian welfare state perspective, at least the enthusiasm for a free market went too far. In Russia and many other countries, economic shock therapy and market reform was introduced before rule of law. There were reasons for this, but the consequences are seen today. Wealth disparity in Russia is far larger than in other developed countries, while rule of the strongest still prevails over rule of law. Corruption is everywhere. Human rights are challenged ideologically by the resurgence of ideas that often are labeled traditional values. Human rights are also challenged by the surge of anti-fact propaganda and distortion. We also notice that the legitimacy of human rights is challenged in societies that feel they no longer need them. The only time in 40 years when the UN and the Human Rights Watch jointly criticized Norway was in 2016, when Norwegian authorities returned asylum seekers to Russia, although they should have known there was danger of refoulement. We have chosen to make the Magnitsky campaign the centerpiece of our anniversary week. Justice for Sergei Magnitsky means punishing the individuals responsible for the death of a whistleblower and the fraud he uncovered. In a larger sense, however, it means support of whistleblowers and human rights defenders everywhere. We want democratic countries to back up resolutions that urge states to support and protect human rights defenders with targeted sanctions against those officials and their partners that kill them or put them in prison and torture them with impunity. The US, Canada, the UK, Estonia and Lithuania have started doing this. I am proud that Norway is a world leader in the fight for human rights defenders. We in the Norwegian Helsinki Committee will wholeheartedly take part in discussions with the Minister of Foreign Affairs and the Norwegian Parliament on how to follow up with innovative and effective tools the very important resolution that the UN General Assembly recently adopted. A resolution which was sponsored by Norway and skillfully negotiated by Norwegian diplomats, facing stern opposition from many states. I count myself fortunate to be part of the Helsinki movement, and today I would like to celebrate the spirit of international solidarity that was and is the basis for the Norwegian Helsinki Committee. Our history teaches us that we achieve results when we work together. We are in this together, and knowing our roots, I look forward with optimism to the next 40 years. Thank you. Let me then introduce the President of the Norwegian Parliament, Olemic Thommessen. It's an honor for me to give you the floor, please.
Dear friends, and especially, of course, everyone from the Helsinki Committee, it's a great day. Congratulations. I'm greatly honored to be invited to this celebration of the 40th anniversary of the Norwegian Helsinki Committee. Today, we are honoring one of the most significant and highly regarded human rights organizations in Europe. The reason for the Norwegian Helsinki Committee's outstanding position is as simple as it is obvious. You are eminently trustworthy. The opinions and analyses you put forward are based on first-hand knowledge. You have reliable sources and contacts on the ground, and your work is founded on academic methods and principles. I have had the welcome opportunity to follow your work for some time. 2 years ago, I visited the committee here in Oslo in order to learn more about the organization and exchange views on how we could complement each other in the promotion of human rights and the protection of democracy. Since then, our paths have crossed on several occasions. I have had the privilege of receiving visits from the committee and some of their guests and collaborators. Likewise, the committee has been invited to take part in some of our parliamentary initiatives. I have always found our meetings informative and inspirational. I know that the same is true for many of my fellow parliamentarians in the Storting, who enjoy close cooperation with the committee through their positions in various international delegations. I would claim that regardless the political orientation of shifting Norwegian governments over the last 40 years, the Norwegian Helsinki Committee has been and continues to be both a partner and a constructive critic on the fields of human rights and democracy. An effective democracy requires us to engender full participation in our democratic processes. It requires that people have a sense of belonging and equality, that they have confidence in the institutions of democracy, and that these institutions are easily accessible and provide equal opportunities for all. A strong and efficient civil society plays a crucial role in this respect. Your support of civil society in many struggling democracies is among your most important endeavors. In many respects, today is a celebration of 40 years of the important and successful defense of democracy and human rights. Unfortunately, rather than being able to celebrate a world where the Helsinki Committee is less important than before, we have to acknowledge that times are increasingly demanding and that the committee continues to be an invaluable resource in trying times. Optimism was strong when the Berlin Wall fell. We experienced a period of great economic development, democratization, and more open societies around the world. But such progress has been met with backlash. Today, yet again, there are dark clouds on the horizon. The position of human rights in parts of our continent does not meet the standards we have committed ourselves to uphold. In many young democracies, democratic development has come to a halt or even been reversed. Through major projects and close contact with authorities in many struggling countries, the Helsinki Committee works to achieve systemic structural change. At the same time, your fight for the lives and rights of individual human rights activists. By becoming work these two approaches, by combining work these two approaches, you are able to play a part in arenas of society that are less acceptable to governments and international parliamentary delegation. I would like to close by congratulating the Norwegian Helsinki Committee on 40 years of vital work, and not least, to wish you the very best of luck for the future and Davis. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your very kind words. It's a great honor then to introduce the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Ine Marie Eriksen Søreide, please.
Dear Secretary General, or as I would like to say, dear Bjorn, ambassadors, excellencies, friends, and last but not least, dear prize winners. It's an honor to be among defenders of human rights. Fighting for human rights is a long-term effort. You need stamina and you need determination to keep going, even when there is little or even no hope of any progress. And you need courage. The network of Helsinki committees came out of the dialogue and negotiations in the Conference on Security and Cooperation in Europe in the early 70s. The first Helsinki Committee was established in Moscow in 1976. Only 1 year later, the Norwegian Helsinki Committee was established. From the beginning, there has been close cooperation between the Norwegian Committee and the Russian human rights movement. Today, we face a more serious security policy situation than just a few years ago. International norms and rules, as well as human rights and indeed democracy itself, is increasingly under pressure, and some places under direct attack. And that's precisely why we need organizations and individuals willing and able to fight the good fight for human rights. The monitoring and reporting work of the Norwegian Helsinki Committee is now more important than ever. You tell the stories of brave men and women who take great risk for the cause of human rights. Support to individual human rights defenders is also crucial. As Bjorn mentioned earlier this week, the Norwegian-led UN Human Rights Defender Resolution was adopted in the UN General Assembly by consensus. And by consensus can sound quite boring, but I can tell you that an increasing number of resolutions that until recently was adopted by consensus is now the object of division and voting. And that is a development that is cause for concern. But hard work resulted in that 76 countries signed up as co-sponsors. The resolution is a strong and clear message in support of human rights defenders. And I would like to thank Norwegian and international civil society for their partnership and their tireless efforts and work in securing support for our resolution. Human rights defenders will remain high on our agenda. And we look forward to continued cooperation with civil society and human rights defenders in the follow-up of the resolution in 2018, when we also mark the 20th anniversary of the Declaration on Human Rights Defenders. Freedom of speech and of the media is another key priority for Norway. Journalists go where most of us are unable or unwilling to go. They shed light on atrocities and expose violations of human rights. Journalists are threatened and imprisoned and in some cases even killed for doing their job. The Norwegian Helsinki Committee has this year chosen the newspaper Novaya Gazeta and the organization Committee Against Torture as worthy recipients of the Sakharov Freedom Award 2017. They are both excellent examples of how media and civil society organizations play a crucial role in defending human rights. Dear friends, I share your commitment to human rights. The Norwegian Helsinki Committee has been in business for 40 years. I've worked with you in some form or shape for the last 10 of them. You have proven that you have the courage, the stamina, and the determination to fight for human rights in the long run. I'm almost tempted to use an analogy from a field I know nothing about, but still I'll try. I'm tempted to say the Norwegian Helsinki Committee is a marathon runner for human rights. That's nothing less than impressive, I can tell you. So congratulations with 40 years on a mission for human rights. And please continue your hard work for the 40 years to come. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Let me also express how grateful we are for the cooperation that we in the Norwegian Helsinki Committee do have with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. As late as today, many of our guests and we within the committee had a number of different meetings with your diplomats throughout the day. The next speaker, Jonas Gahr Støre, leader of the Labour Party, please.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, and in particular, guests who have traveled to Norway, be welcome, and the prize winners, indeed, you are the guests of honor tonight in Oslo. I have noticed that men of my age, when invited to say something nice about somebody, they tend to speak about themselves. And I thought that I would make no exception tonight, because the whole notion of the Helsinki Accord, the Sakharov Prize, brings back to me some of the strongest moment of wakening up that shaped my life and my political conscience. And the man who we will honor tonight with the name of the prize, Andrei Sakharov, plays a special role. I can remember perhaps the first moment where I really had a political wakening up, 1975. Andrei Sakharov was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize and Moscow refused him to go to Oslo. Or was it the other way around, that he did not want to go, fearing that he would not be let back into the Soviet Union so that he could continue his struggle? Instead, we all got acquainted with the extraordinary brave woman Elena Bonner. And this story was to follow me in part of my youth during my studies in Paris. Part of my extra student work was to go to the Soviet Union with medicines and information to meet the so-called dissidents. Many in this room did the same. And we led an international campaign to get Andrei Sakharov out of Gorky and back to some decency in Moscow. A seemingly impossible task against such a monolithic regime. But what we learned was yet another example that the impossible can become possible if people really dedicate their convictions, their faith, and decent values that should apply to all. Sakharov was released, and one of the finest moments in my youth was when I had the opportunity to go to Moscow and meet him a few days after he came out of his forced exile. So making the impossible possible, and let me then add, insisting that justice and human rights should apply to all, that was one of Sakharov's messages, and in full spirit with the Helsinki Accords. I think it is important to remember young people, students, and even older people, of the notion of those accords, what they meant to Europe. The three baskets of political and military aspects of security, economic and environmental aspects of security, and the human dimensions of security. Very intelligent and creative at the time. And it was a breakthrough. It helped change Europe, although it took a few years to the end of the next decade to really secure it. And the Helsinki Committee, regretfully, still has plenty of work to do. And I salute you for looking into the dark shades of regimes to find those areas where you still are so needed. I believe Norway should continue to be at the forefront of promoting the role and values of the OSCE, even in dire times when military means are again applied to change borders, and when free will and democracies and democratic deeds are tread upon in far too many countries. So let me then end with a message to all those individuals, some very brave ones here, some people we don't know the name in countries, and some familiar faces here in Oslo who have been committed to this cause for many, many years. And I will make no exception, I will again talk slightly about myself, because sometimes I feel when I go to bed that I can go to bed a bit more secure and a bit more comforted because I know that these people are out there looking after other people's freedom and thus after my freedom. Bjørn Engesland is saying that defending human rights is everyone's job. I agree. But somebody has to be everyone. And you make that work on behalf of all of us and remind us that we really should appreciate that and that we should also take part. We can sleep a bit more comforted because we know that you are looking into the darkness at noon that Köstler wrote about back in 1940 and which still, unfortunately, is reality in far too many countries. And you will be there looking after the dignity of individuals when big politics keep rolling forward, when Assad is embracing Putin in Sochi, and when the conflict in Ukraine continues to burn, and when strong men dominate in countries like Chechnya. So it is perhaps a small gesture in the big picture that you look after the right of the individuals. But it is the combination of all those deeds that make you great, that make us safer, and that makes it such a great pleasure to celebrate 40 years. One could have thought that in 1989, the Helsinki Committee could pack up its suitcases, close its offices, and do something else. You didn't. And I thank you for that, and I salute you for your effort. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Jonas Gahr Støre. We will have a small break in a long list of speeches. I will introduce Paul Moddi Knudsen, a Norwegian singer and musician from Senja, northern Norway. Paul Moddi has won several awards, the last he received as late as this afternoon. He will introduce his two songs himself, and I'm very much looking forward to listen to you, Paul Moddi.
Hi, everybody. It's a bit of an honour, really, to be invited to play for the Helsinki Committee. We have been touring now for 2 years with a project called Unsungs. It's a project where I've been gathering censored and illegal songs from all over the world and translated them into English and present them in a sort of pop musical language. And incidentally, one of the songs on the album come from the home country of this year's prize winners. But I have to admit, the first time I listened to Pussy Riot's music, I wasn't amazed. I mean, I sort of come from the folksy background and enjoy an acoustic guitar and maybe a cello and a flute, and this was nowhere near it. Still, there was something incredibly interesting about this story, about the women who got 2 years in prison for performing their punk prayer in 2012. It made me sit down. It made me want to understand what the fuss was all about. So I tried to make a sort of Norwegianized version, interpretation of Pussy Riot's music, how it could have sounded if they were born in a fjord in northern Norway and grew up and had a peaceful life by the sea before they wrote their punk prayer. Golden morning. hats upon their frocks. Freedom's ghost hath left these lands. Help us if you can. KGB have turned to saints. Gay parades sent off in chains. Blessed limousines congest the streets to hail their saint in chief. Holy Mary, drive Putin away. Drive away this darkness from your halls. Drive away the ungodly souls. Our Lady, tear the eagle off your wounds. Father Gunjayev pays back from his back of holy crap. Woman, keep quiet and love your man, your fate and fatherland. Oh, Holy Mary, be a feminist. Pray not for the mighty but the meek. Drive away the lies that they speak. Our Lady, hear our prayer unto thee. Oh. Gunji never cared for God. Oh, that dickhead wants his power. Mary, your belt should bring us hope. Now it's used as rope. Oh, damn their lies, deliver us. Pry the copper from the cross. Mary, our hands are tied in. I asked very politely if I could do two songs because playing just one song from this project always turns out wrong, because the whole project has been about one thing: showing that censorship is something that happens absolutely everywhere and isn't something that you can isolate to, I don't know, authoritarian regimes, that you can isolate to places that are far away in space and time. Censorship is something that happens absolutely everywhere, and we'd like to finish with a song that proves that far too well. This is a song that was removed from the English BBC in 1991 during the Gulf War, along with 66 other songs that mentioned war, peace, bombs, aeroplanes, or air. They removed I Shot the Sheriff, and they removed Back in the USSR. They removed Norwegian Aha's Hunting High and Low because it had the word hunting in the title. And all these sound like silly examples, but they also removed John Lennon's Imagine and Give Peace a Chance. And that sort of gives you an impression of how afraid the BBC were to broadcast songs that could be interpreted to be critical towards the warfare that the great that Great Britain were part of in the Persian Gulf. This is a song by Kate Bush called Army Dreamers, a short and fairly sweet song about a soldier who goes to war and returns home in a coffin. Nothing more. But that was enough for the BBC to remove it. So here's Kate Bush's Army Dreamers.
If we had more time, I guess we should just have continued with this concert. Thank you very much, both of you. The next speaker is Liv
Tørres, the director of the Nobel Peace Center, the place where we are today. And I would like to use the opportunity to thank you and your staff for an excellent cooperation with organizing this event and the whole day of yesterday. You have an excellent staff around you. Please.
Thank you. I know, actually. Well, I was planning to start thanking you. But let me first say, ladies and gentlemen, prize winners, and not the least, the Helsinki Committee. 40 years. That should make you probably sort of in a perfect age group. You've matured. I mean, you will still keep maturing and you will still keep getting more vigilant, but 40 years old is a good age. You're a watchdog, really. You spend all your time promoting human rights, defending human rights promoters. And I think the watchdog role is more critical than ever before. You are doing it through various means, but you keep being principled. You said initially that this is, we all have that job. And Jonas pointed to the fact that you are really everyone for us. But I'm very, very happy that you keep reminding everyone, and politicians in particular, that it is everyone's job. Now, it is everyone's job, but at the same time, we know that human rights are under pressure. The right to organize is under pressure, the freedom of speech is under pressure, democracy is under pressure. More than half the world's population now live in countries where there is no democracy or very little democracy. We see authoritarian systems on the increase. More authoritarian states, we also see that authoritarian leaders are showing more creativity and flexibility in the tools that they are using. Very often they have elections and they have democracy on paper, but in practice it's something totally different. It makes your job much harder. It makes your job more pressurized. You have to also be more creative and more flexible in order to find out what the situation is and how to promote and defend those that need it most. We live in a difficult time, but one where your role is more important than ever. And I think the important point is also that you are pointing out when things are sliding. We have to all be able to defend human rights even when we have to pay for it ourselves. Human rights, if we start sliding, things get really serious and it's difficult to stop the sliding. We are actually now finding ourselves in the midst of an exhibition. 12 young European photographers have photographed shifting boundaries that we see every day now in Europe. We see authoritarian movements are growing, we see human rights violations, we see closed borders, we see increasing inequality, we see civil rights movements under pressure, we see that borders and boundaries are changing. And who would have thought a few years back that we would have seen the stronghold of human rights now struggling to basically defend our own heritage. We thank you for doing your job in stopping the sliding. We thank you for doing your job in reminding all of us that human rights is actually the most important pillar on which our societies develop, grow. We thank you for speaking for those of us who are not able to do it, either because they're in jail, because they have to remain anonymous, or because they need particular support and solidarity. We thank you for all of that. There's more than 20 Nobel Peace Prize laureates, actually, that have received their prizes because of their human rights work. We will see others in the future, but I think that also points to the importance of human rights work through history and particularly now. I'm not going to quote Sakharov, but I'm going to quote Liu Xiaobo, who said that the freedom of expression is the base of human rights, the root of human nature, and the mother of truth. To kill free speech is to insult human rights, to stifle human nature, and to suppress truth. You are on guard. You are the voices of the most vulnerable. You are the watchdog. And in many ways, you have challenged and you keep on challenging the shifting boundaries that we see around us. So we are very, very happy to host you here. Instead of you thanking us, we would like to very much thank you and keep up the great work. Because although the age of 40 is fantastic, the age of 50 is going to be great, the age of 60, and I totally trust that you are going to keep up your work and defend all of us at the end of the day. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you. Thank you very much. The next speaker is someone we have worked closely with for many years. Natalia Kaliada, she's the founding co-artistic director of Belarus Free Theatre. This is an underground theatre group formed in response to the severe censorship and repression in her home country, Belarus. Natalia has been detained several times for participation in peaceful political and theatrical activities and lives today in London. Please.
My name is Natalia Kaliada, and I'm co-founding director of Belarus Free Theatre. Usually when I say Belarus Free Theatre, people clearly understand the second and the third words, but not the first one. I very much hope it's not the case for tonight's audience, but let's check it. Do you know where Belarus is located? Yes, no, yeah, clearly no, probably. Could you imagine I repeat this joke for 24 years? My husband came up with a great thing. He said, like, listen, ask people where Russia is located. Do you know where Russia is located? Do you know where Russia is located? Yes, yes. And he said, listen, give an answer. Russia is located between Belarus and China. So now you understand how important we are. So yeah, and please keep in mind that I'm from Eastern Europe and we are, generally speaking, not very polite people. We say what we think in a very harsh manner, blaming others, of course, for their situation we find ourselves in. And I don't think that we are often regarded as very grateful people, but also very important. Eastern Europeans, when they're given 4 minutes to give a speech, it's enough for us to say just hi, because we usually answer the question, how are you? We give a full answer. But putting jokes aside, Nothing has changed in our part of the world. Even after the collapse of the Soviet Union, nothing has changed politically for people there. The West found a huge market there as capitalism took hold. Just as Russian oligarchs began to move their money out of the country and relocate them in secure democratic countries, positioning themselves as powerful investors into the economies of democratic countries. It was a trap, negating any future economic sanctions from the West against Russia because it would be so bad for business and the economy. And what of human rights? They were utterly obliterated. There are still people in jails. The war is going on in Ukraine. You have to ask, at what price a human life? I belong to a generation born under the Soviet Union. I remember my parents whispering in the kitchen and saying that the walls have ears, so we can't talk. The Soviet Union only collapsed in 1991. In 1994, Alexander Lukashenko, better known as the last dictator of Europe, came to power. He is still there, even though political circles of Europe now say that Belarus is normal. Major opponents to the Belarusian regime got kidnapped and killed in 1991 and 2000. Their bodies were never found. Those who perpetrated those crimes are still in power. What it happens, it is no longer possible for you to stay outside and observe. That particular moment, we are converted into fighters, people whose main weapon is a body, your own body and your friends' bodies, who together decide to use themselves to challenge the system. The artist's position is that of non-violent resistance. We feel that we are far stronger than any secret police, as our weapon is morality and creativity. We don't have time or luxury to be apolitical. Dostoevsky once said that beauty will save the world. I prefer the words of Boris Groys, who reworked a little and said, the arts will save the world from beauty. I wish we could all find the strength to be free. It is such a painful process to be free. We're almost same age with Norwegian Helsinki Committee. Over 40 years of my life, how many friends of mine lost their lives, and my family members were put under attacks. Over 40 years, how many human lives are saved by an incredible team of the Norwegian Helsinki Committee? We bring so much pain to our families. We lose our friends. We go through repressions because of our beliefs in the fight for human rights. The fight could go forward only if we know we are no left alone in cold ice of repressions. When we know behind us people like you who could help us to break through that wall of ice. Like it was in a case of Fram, that I consider at the best metaphor of a joint work of Norwegian Helsinki Committee and human rights defenders in different parts of the world. Fridtjof Nansen wrote on the 27th of July, 1893, just as our prospects were at the darkest and we were preparing to seek a way back out of the ice, which kept getting even denser, the joyful tidings came that fog was lifting. The first bout with the ice showed us plainly what an excellent ice boat the Fram was. No channel between the floes, so windy and awkward, but she could get through it. And the ship swings round and wriggles her way forward among the floes without touching, if there is only just an opening wide enough for her to slip through. And where there is none, she drives full tilt at the ice with her heavy plunge, runs her sloping bows up, threads and under it, and bursts the floes asunder. And how strong she is too, as I consider Helsinki Committee. Hope can be transformed into a dream, and dreams can come true when we move from words to actions. The main challenge we have as artists and human beings is how to convert pain into hope, how to ensure that we do not forget the dignity of a man. After we got smuggled out of Belarus, my father lost his voice. The only thing left for him to do was to whisper. Even though my father is losing his voice, again and again. I know that for as long as he can whisper, my daughters have a chance to understand what freedom means. I know when the Norwegian Helsinki Committee exists, there is still a chance for freedoms come true in our part of the world. It seems that Fram made all major explorations, but in reality, there is a huge discover for all of us. There is still a hope to discover and establish the youngest democracy in the center of Europe. It is only possible if all together with people of Belarus, Ukraine, Russia, people of Europe, people of Norway, and Norwegian Helsinki Committee, we all go forward. We all become Fram, whether in whispers or in Wales, we together have to disturb the sleeping conscious that absorbs the world. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Lyudmilla Alekseyeva, one of the founders of the Moscow Helsinki group back in 1976, as it was said earlier, the first Helsinki committee to be established. At the age of 90, she is still working hard to defend human rights. For many years, she was forced to live outside her country. She was unable to come here today due to her health situation and has asked her colleague, Valeriy Borshov, to present her greetings to us. Valeriy Borshov is a well-known human rights activist in Russia, currently a chairman of the Moscow City Public Oversight Commission and a member of Moscow Helsinki Group. Please, the floor is yours.
Дорогие друзья, Людмила Михайловна попросила меня прочесть ее приветственное слово. Дорогой Бьерн, дорогие коллеги, я очень сожалею, что не смогу вместе с вами встретить ваш солидный юбилей, но душой я с вами. Я не понаслышке знаю, что значит посвятить 40 лет защите прав человека. Несмотря на нередкие разочарования, вы остаетесь в строю. Более того, вы по-прежнему в авангарде международного хельсинского движения. Вы не представляете, какое огромное значение для нас, находившихся за железным занавесом в Советском Союзе, имело то, что наш призыв к созданию групп поддержки на Западе был услышан. Одними из первых на этот призыв ответили вы, наши норвежские друзья. Мы всегда помним об этом с большой благодарностью. Это был пример настоящей солидарности. Впереди был общий путь с победами и поражениями длиной 40 лет. Я всегда помню, что благодаря вашим усилиям были освобождены из тюрьмы мои товарищи и многие правозащитники последующих десятилетий. Вы своей благородной деятельностью способствовали падению железного занавеса и тому, что права человека в нашей стране все большим числом людей стали восприниматься не как абстрактная теория, а как насущная необходимость. А для россиян вы стали достойными посланниками Норвегии и норвежских граждан, помогая им защищать свои права и человеческое достоинство. В моей стране знают о Норвегии не только благодаря нефти, красной рыбе и биатлону, но и благодаря гуманитарной просветительской работе норвежских правозащитников, в первую очередь норвежского Хельсинского комитета. Мы прошли вместе большой путь, сейчас еще немало проблем в нашей стране, еще далеко до демократии и свободы и в России, и в других постсоветских странах. Но я верю в светлое будущее, потому что среди нынешней молодежи несравненно больше, чем среди моих соотечественников 40 лет назад, тех, кто готов продолжать наше общее дело. В день вашего 40-летия я желаю вам по-прежнему быть в авангарде международного хельсинского движения, продолжать проявлять солидарность и помогать тем, кто в вашей помощи нуждается, становиться лучше и сильнее за нашу и вашу свободу. Председатель Московской хельсинской группы Людмила Алексеева. От себя я хочу добавить, дорогие друзья, как член Московской хельсинской группы, я хорошо помню, как возникало Хельсинское движение. Я вступил в правозащитное диссидентское движение в 1975 году после знакомства с Андреем Дмитриевичем Сахаровым. И идея Хельсинского движения принадлежит Юрию Федоровичу Орлову. И главный ключ, главная ценность, то, что это была идея солидарности, солидарности международной, это давало огромную силу правозащитному движению. Я ездил на станцию Часовая в Пермскую область, где были сосредоточены лагеря для политзаключенных. В 34-м лагере сидел Юрий Орлов и Глеб Якуин, в 36-м Сергей Адамович Ковалев, и передавал информацию, как говорили тогда, на голоса BBC, «Голос Америки». И вот реакция международной общественности, реакция правозащитников, реакция Хельсинского международного движения, она помогала нам выжить и давала много силы. Сегодня также актуальна проблема международной солидарности, потому что в России идет серьезный откат от демократических основ. Правозащитники сегодня находятся в тяжелейшем состоянии, и ситуация с правами человека очень тяжелая. Мы через 3 дня у нас будет съезд правозащитников, там тоже будет выступать Людмила Михайловна, и мы будем говорить о наших проблемах. Но еще раз повторяю, лозунг «За нашу и вашу свободу», лозунг международной солидарности сегодня в высшей степени актуален. Спасибо.
Thank you very much, Valeriy. It's an honor for me to introduce the chairperson of the board of the Norwegian Helsinki Committee, Ragnhild Astrup. Tschudi, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Dear Excellencies and distinguished guests, and brave visiting colleagues and friends, as we all know, no birthday party is complete without a gift. Although our gift wish, the creation of a human rights emergency fund, is one we would rather not have. But the way the human rights situation has worsened in most of the countries where we are working has made us feel the need to create a readiness to help our partners there on short notice. And that is difficult in our strictly project-financed existence. That's why we're launching the Norwegian Helsinki Committee Human Rights Emergency Fund today, thanks to the generosity of the business community in Norway, and especially law firm Vikbor Rein. It is for the brave, even heroic, human rights defenders we work with. The Norwegian Helsinki Committee was founded 40 years ago, in solidarity with the plight of the Moscow Helsinki Group. This gift for the Norwegian Helsinki Committee is now continuing this spirit of international solidarity. The emergency fund will make us able to support human rights defenders in urgent need of assistance and react quickly in emergency situations, such as threats of imminent arrest, acute medical treatment after injuries, legal assistance, or send observers on short notice after armed conflicts in order to document crimes. The need for this type of urgent action has sadly become all too clear over the years. Our partners almost all face worsening human rights situation. One example. In 2009, we lost one of our brave colleagues in Chechnya, Natalia Estemirova, to abduction and murder. Natalia was the head of the Russian human rights organization Memorial's office in Chechnya and worked tirelessly for justice in a dangerous region. We know that decisive and quick action can save lives. When Natalia was killed in 2009, the Norwegian Helsinki Committee, with the help of the Norwegian government, was able to quickly relocate two of her threatened colleagues from Chechnya, who are now working with the Norwegian Helsinki Committee here in Oslo. Our new Chechen colleagues have been able to carry on their important work. And with their help, we have established the Natalia Estemirova Documentation Center here in Oslo. It is a comprehensive database that contains vast amounts of information documenting grave crimes committed in Russia's North Caucasus region. And material from the database has been used, among other things, to place a name of the Magnitsky sanctions list. This is a step towards justice. It's also a model for how we, who are so fortunate to live in a democracy, can use this privilege to further the cause of human rights elsewhere. In a world that is becoming ever more interconnected, human rights are the only feasible common standard. In order to avoid conflicts, we need a common set of rules. Human rights should be just that. We would love to have been able to do something to avoid our friend, the 47-year-old Ilgar Mamadov, be imprisoned in Azerbaijan. He was arrested in 2013 after traveling to northern Azerbaijan to observe and report on riots. In 2014, he was sentenced to 7 years in prison on fabricated charges of inciting mass violence and is still in prison in bad conditions. Our emergency fund is an answer to the need for immediate action, which requires some financial flexibility and independence. This is crucial when working when crises emerge rather than after the fact. That can make all the difference. Business and human rights groups have a shared interest in the rule of law. It is good to feel support, not only in the form of money, but support for what we believe in and the work we do. I would like to thank the donors here today represented by the law firm Vik Borein for one of the best gifts we could wish for, a real rapid response tool in defense of victims of human rights abuse. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ragnhild. Before the Sakharov Award ceremony, we will have one more artistic performance. And our own senior advisor, Inna Sangatsieva, will introduce the theater group Teatr.Doc before it perform a small piece for us. Please.
My guess is that everyone here is passionate about promoting and protecting human rights. One way that we do that is by collecting solid information and writing reports to document abuses. Perhaps not all the reports are exciting, though. In fact, they may at many times rather boring. But documenting human rights abuses is too important to be boring. That is why we in Norwegian Helsinki Committee cooperate with Belarus Free Theatre. And now it is my pleasure to introduce Teatr.Doc. Teatr.Doc is not usual Russian theatre. Teatr.Doc was established in 2002. It is an independent group which has been working entirely with the documentation of the present state, the acute issues of the post-Soviet, post-empire, post-traumatic society. Teatr.Doc is an important organization in Russia as it motivates people to look at their own past, their own lives, cure the wounds, even recover human dignity from an authoritarian state. Teatr.Doc is constantly being pressured by the authorities. However, the pressure does not stop them from working on taboo issues. The Norwegian Helsinki Committee is proud to cooperate with Teatr.Doc and its head, Elena Milashina, who is here with us today. Now you will see an extract from their performance, The Human Rights Activists, which will give us all a short glance into how today's Russian dissidents managed to conduct their important work. As the performance is in Russian, please remember to put on your headphones. Please welcome.
Добрый вечер, уважаемое собрание. В нашем спектакле представлено 11 монологов правозащитников, действующих сейчас в России. Мы представим вам два. Многие из наших героев сегодня присутствуют в этом зале.
Да. Андрей Бабушкин, один из самых известных и влиятельных российских правозащитников. В первую очередь он занимается правами заключенных, тюрьмами, условиями содержания в полицейских участках. Андрея Владимировича, как никого другого, одинаково сильно уважают и тюремное начальство, и заключенные, и его коллеги, правозащитники.
Вот я сама лично брала интервью для нашего спектакля у Андрея Бабушкина, и он произвел на меня очень большое такое сильное человеческое впечатление. Он назначил нам встречу уже достаточно поздно, было 10:30 вечера, и мы даже думали, что интервью не состоится, потому что он работает круглосуточно, люди шли непрерывным потоком. Им нужна была реальная помощь, и мы думали, что не получится. Но все-таки интервью состоялось, и вот что он нам рассказал. У нас нет адвокатов. У нас 2,5 человека работают в офисе, я третий. Наиболее сложными делами я занимаюсь, наиболее простыми мои помощники. Зарплату мы им не платим. Нам просто не из чего ее платить.
Скажите, а были случаи, когда вам было обидно?
Бывает ли обидно?
Да.
Бывает. Ну, в принципе, я привык. Ну, вообще, как бы ждать благодарности от заключенных. Человек, собственно, попадает в этот мир именно из-за того, что он был неблагодарен. Но он не ценил того, что ему было дано в детстве, в юности. И вот наша задача – изменить этот его моральный вектор, чтобы он понял свою морально-нравственную ориентацию.
И что, получается?
Ну, иногда получается, иногда нет.
А можете вот рассказать вот этот механизм смены морально-нравственных координат?
Ну, вот там спрашиваешь у человека, за что сел? Ну, он говорит, там, подрался, набил морду, так получилось. Я говорю, а ты знаешь, чем отличается преступник от непреступника? Человек говорит, ну, наверное, преступник – это тот, который преступление совершает, а непреступник – это тот, который не совершает. Я говорю, нет. Непреступник тоже может совершить преступление. Просто у него никогда нет такого ответа. Так получилось. Он всегда точно знает причину. Он знает, где и в чем он ошибся. Человек, конечно, начинает со мной там спорить, вступает со мной в дискуссию. Вот несколько раз у меня такое было. Потом встречаешь этого человека на свободе. И он говорит, вы знаете, что для меня отсчет свободы начался не с того момента, как я физически вышел на свободу, а вот с этого нашего с вами разговора. Мне тогда так стыдно стало, что вы мне так сказали. Я потом все время с вами начал спорить внутренне. И вот чем больше я думал и спорил, тем больше я с вами соглашался. И вот сейчас я уже 2 года как на свободе, у меня уже этого не повторится. Я точно знаю причину. Вот таких вот несколько случаев у меня было.
Бумага из факса. Правозащитник равно моральный урод. Кто все эти люди? С чего это они стали общественностью? Гоните их с ссаными тряпками из страны нах.
10 сентября исполнилось 13 лет со дня смерти моей мамы, Светланы Марковны Радштейн. Моя мама была уникальным человеком. Она была архитектором, проектировала промышленные зоны северных городов. Потом она заболела онкологией, перенесла сложнейшую операцию, выкарабкалась, начала жизнь абсолютно с нуля. Открыла индивидуальное дело, никаких сбережений у нее не было. Научилась водить машину, на горных лыжах кататься, посетила более 20 стран. Вот эта страсть к путешествиям от нее ко мне передалась. И когда у нашей организации заканчивались грантовые средства, а людям же это неведомо, им нужна помощь постоянно, они не могут ждать. Мама очень часто помогала нам, поддерживала материально нашу организацию. У нее были обширные планы на будущее.
Я по какому-то делу зашел к Бабушкину в его комитет за гражданские права. Я смотрю, там на стене портрет в травной рамке женщины. Ну и мне говорят, что это мама Андрея Бабушкина. Что он помогал какому-то парню пораньше освободиться, потом на воле он помог ему устроиться на работу. И этот парень взял и ограбил его дом и жестоко зарезал его маму. 18 ножевых ранений. И мы думали, что Андрей после этого, конечно же, не будет заниматься правозащитой, не вернется. Ну, вот прошло какое-то время, и вот он снова вернулся и снова помогает людям.
На могиле моей мамы я пытаюсь бывать каждый месяц,
Вот больше всего, наверное, мне мешает вот это. Вот это нарастающее чувство бессилия и безнадежности. Да? Что даже если мы будем совершать подвиги, возможно, никто о них не узнает. Никто же не знает, как себя вел Мирхольд. Плохо или хорошо, когда ему сломали все пальцы, а потом утопили в нечистотах, в подвалах Лубянки. Никто не знает. И вот я чувствую, что я к этому не готов. И вот это мне очень больше всего и угнетает, что я пока не готов вот к этому.
Андрей Юров, правозащитник, тренер, преподаватель по правам человека, поэт, писатель, социальный философ, член Совета по правам человека при президенте Российской Федерации.
Вы знаете, вот самое сложное, наверное, последние, не знаю, лет 15, наверное, да, это, извините, то, что с каждым, значит, что все хуже и хуже ситуация. Потому что до этого был другой тренд. До этого был тренд, что с каждым годом все больше и больше возможностей. А потом стало понятно, что ситуация, в общем-то, становится все более и более трагичной, безнадежной. И вот это как раз потеря. У меня есть длинный пассаж, я сейчас не буду его воспроизводить. Он очень гневный и жесткий. По поводу так называемого выгорания. Потому что я считаю, что вот под словом выгорание очень модным сейчас принято подводить все, начиная от собственной, извините, лени и заканчивая действительно какой-то реальной усталостью. Так вот, мне кажется, что единственная вещь, напрямую связанная с выгоранием, это когда человек понимает, что все, что он делает, бесполезно. Понимаете, да? И вот несколько, я помню, несколько лет назад я разговаривал с одним диссидентом, старым. И я ему так пожаловался, что меня убивает отсутствие надежды, что, скорее всего, все что я не верю, что я доживу, когда все изменится, вот хотя бы в этой стране, что, скорее всего, все закончится эмиграцией там, или тюрьмой. А он мне говорит, этот старый человек, он говорит, а ты понимаешь, почему мы, по большому счету, победили? Ну, то есть, конечно, не мы победили, но глобально так получилось, что мы победили. Мы победили по одной причине. У нас не было надежды. Тебе нужно перестать надеяться. Просто прекращай этим заниматься. Вот когда ты перестанешь надеяться, вот просто вот да, такая жизнь. Да, умереть. Да, возможно, умереть, так и не увидев ничего, как многие. Да, возможно, умереть в эмиграции, как многие. Да, возможно, умереть в тюрьме. Вот такая твердая, устойчивость, да? Ты делаешь то, что ты должен делать. Что должен делать человек с большой буквы на твоем месте. Ты, вот, ты попытайся стать вот этим человеком, про которого ты книжки читал. Прекращай надеяться. Надежда, он говорит, надежда – это опора трусов. Трусам нужна, чем, ну, нужна надежда. Им нужно постоянно чем-то оправдывать свои действия. Им нужно все время про эффективность говорить. Потому что, вы знаете, вот, вот уже лучше. Вот мы уже становимся эффективнее. Вот знаете, мы уже столько-то людей привлекли. Вообще, видите, лучше. Надежда-то есть. Серьезно. Вы знаете, вот по статистике областного МВД в прошлом году пытали 500 человек. А в этом году, знаете сколько? 499. Вот видите, какие изменения глобальные. Вот все лучше, все лучше. А если мы еще семинар проведем, то в следующем году будет 497, а через 500 лет всего один человек будет, вот, которого пытать. И вот он мне говорит, этот дед, твою мать, прекращай надеяться. Прекращай просто этим заниматься, ты не понимаешь, а? Ваше поколение хлипкое, вы проиграете. Вы все свалите либо за рубеж, либо из сектора, потому что вы продолжаете надеяться. Вы поколение, которое выросло на проектном мышлении. Вам нужны проекты и реальные результаты. А мы не мыслили результатами. Мы мыслили человеком. Человеком, который стоит перед лицом космоса. Вот этим заброшенным теперь абсолютным героем, который стоит перед космосом и совершает то, что должен делать человек перед лицом космоса. Вот этим героем, хотите Сартра, хотите Ницше, вот он стоит и совершает. И зная, что, возможно, он сгниет в вонючей яме. И никто никогда не узнает, как он себя повел, хорошо или плохо. А это не важно. Это не важно, узнает, не узнает. Вот как только ты избавишься от этой надежды, ты станешь воином.
Thank you very much. We are grateful to have had actors from the Teatr.Doc with us for these two last days. The last part of this event is the Sakharov Award ceremony. I do give the floor to the president of the Council of the Norwegian Helsinki Committee, Nora Sveos. Please.
Thank you, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. At this 40th anniversary of the Norwegian Helsinki Committee, the board of the committee has decided to give the Andrei Sakharov Freedom Award to two important institutions in the Russian society, namely the Russian Committee Against Torture and to Novaya Gazeta, the newspaper. And today, I have been given the great honor of presenting the very brave, dedicated, and highly skilled representatives of the recipients of the prestigious prize, namely Elena Milashina and Olga Sadovskaya, and we will soon see them up here with me. But before I talk anymore about the two fine individuals and their important work, I will say some words about the Andrei Sakharov and the prize that carries his name. The award aims at highlighting the work of persons who, because of their commitment to human rights, to religion or to conscience, risk persecution and imprisonment. The Norwegian Helsinki Committee established this prize in 1980 with full support and with the full consent of Andrei Sakharov himself. Since then, Many courageous and very dedicated persons have been awarded this acknowledgement of their work. To promote and defend human rights, to support and protect human rights defenders and their fights for the rights of survivors of serious human rights abuses. Earlier prize winners include Sharta 77 from what was then Czechoslovakia, furthermore, Segevni Sotis from Kazakhstan, Svetlana Ganushkina from Russia, Ales Bialyaski from Belarus, and Sergei Kovalov from Russia. And the last time the prize was awarded was in 2014 to political prisoners in Azerbaijan. Now back to the great ladies sitting here close to us now, namely Elena, and representing Novaya Gazeta, probably the only independent newspaper in the Russian Federation, and to Olga Sadovskaya, representing the Russian Committee Against Torture, that for more than 16 years has constantly been working to fight impunity for the crime of torture. Together, the award winners and their institutions represent very strong voices in support for human rights and the victims of human rights abuses. They are professional, uncompromising, and full of initiatives, be it to do in-depth research in order to bring up to daylight severe and ongoing violations, or be it the constant struggle for justice and accountability for those responsible for torture. Because the lawyers of the Committee Against Torture and the journalists of Novaya Gazeta are excellent examples of how mutual respect for fundamental human rights in various professions and locations reinforce and cross-fertilize each other's important work. Before I go on saying more about this, I want to quote one of the concerns that was expressed by the UN Committee Against Torture in their concluding observations to the report of Russia considered in 2012. The committee says, "It is concerned over persistent reports of the widespread practice in the State Party of torture and ill-treatment of detainees, including as a means to extract confessions. It notes the discrepancy between the large number of complaints of torture and ill-treatment and the relatively small number of criminal cases brought in response, leading to prosecution. So the committee recommends to the State Party, as a matter of urgency, the State Party should take immediate and effective measures to prevent all acts of torture and ill-treatment throughout the country and to eliminate impunity for those allegedly responsible. The State Party should unequivocally reaffirm the absolute prohibition of torture and publicly make clear that perpetrators and those complicit or acquiescent in torture will be held responsible for their abuses and will be subject to criminal prosecution and appropriate sanctions." End of quotation. This is, of course, for the state to take action. But with your persistent work, both of you have obtained so much along these lines, and hopefully, one day, the state will in fact take over and see that this happens in compliance with the many treaty obligations that it has. The Committee Against Torture in Russia was awarded a prize also in 2011, the Human Rights Prize by the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe. The work of the Russian Committee Against Torture is, first of all, investigations of torture and inhuman treatment. It cooperates with media in order to provide information about the torture cases, and it has managed to see a high number of persons, first of all representatives of the security services, imprisoned for the crime of torture. And also, and this is a great accomplishment, they have also obtained reparations to many of the victims. And that is in itself a great victory. When Olga was asked by the Norwegian Crown Prince at our meeting on Monday to tell about a success story, she immediately responded, "We have sent more than 170 persons responsible for torture to prison." He looked a bit surprised at first, and then he immediately understood and was deeply impressed. And your committee also works with what one can call the key principles, one of the key principles of the UN Convention Against Torture, namely education and training. And your projects on education and training is something that you yourself define as a way of torture and elimination, and I could not agree more. The project aims at changing the attitude of law enforcement personnel, sensitize them to human rights and the absolute prohibition against torture. The leader of your organization, Igor Kalyapin, could not be here today, but thanks to his work, and your team, the crime of torture is spoken about, it is known, and you have influenced the Russian authorities in their efforts to change the practice of law enforcement. You started working in the Nizhny Novgorod region, but have expanded your activity to several regions in Russia and created a network of organizations working to achieve the same aims, even in Chechnya. Finally, your work in preparing cases to the European Court of Human Rights, where you have won several of them, leaves us all with great respect and admiration. As for you, Elena, and the important and groundbreaking work of the Novaya Gazeta, a critical and independent newspaper that was established in 1993, and with Dmitry Muratov as responsible editor for most of these years, and as I understand, changed a little bit his role only 2 weeks ago. But what characterizes the work of the paper is that you have your own correspondence. You and your colleagues are digging deep to find connections, disclose critical situations, and you collaborate closely with human rights activists. You mentioned yourself that just during the 20 years that you have been working in the paper, 6 of your colleagues have been killed for their work. So this is very, very clear and a very tragic message that the work that you are doing, lifting injustice to the daylight and pointing at those that are responsible, this is not without serious risks, and nobody is more aware of that than you are. Novaya Gazeta has the staff, the courage, the respect, and the reputation to disseminate their important messages with credibility on the necessary platforms, and does so despite propaganda and threats. With the help of hardworking human rights lawyers in Russian prisons, courts and police stations, and with the journalists, you obtain information from first-hand sources, both from the victims and the specialists in the field. And you disseminate knowledge about human rights and about those defending them. And very important, by this you strengthen the sense of justice, that the sense of justice can prevail, and that it is worth speaking about these problems. Seek professional assistance and claim the rights. This is an important step, not only for the victims of human rights abuses and their relatives, but for the whole Russian society. All of this leaves us with great admiration and deep respect. And I've now come to the next step in this procedure, and I will want very much for both of you to come up here and join me. Dear friends, it's been a great honor to be with you these days. It's been wonderful to know you personally. We have, and I know we will stay in touch, and your work is just fantastic, and all the best, good luck. And now I want to, with my colleagues here, give you, each and one of you, the sign of this knowledge prize, and also give the floor to you. So, here, this is Elena. Olga, this is for you. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Wonderful.
Do you want to? You want to? Thank you so much. Since we're two here, I will be short. I'm not used to speak a lot of words. I used to write a lot of words when I prepare the cases to the course and to European Court of Human Rights. I would like to thank Norwegian Helsinki Committee, Norsves, the board of the committee, and those who have chosen us as the award winners for this year. This makes me very proud. But despite the fact that this is only me here receiving that award today, I want to say that this award actually goes not to myself and not to me. It is the award to our team that works in several cities in Russia. And I'm personally coming from the city where Andrei Sakharov has spent a serious part of his life when he was in exile. This goes to my colleagues who are very smart, brave, and energetic. Maybe they work without hope, but they definitely work with a belief that it will definitely become better in our country when it comes to the protection of human rights. But moreover, I want to thank and to express my gratitude and grace to those victims who trusted us to protect their rights. Because becoming human rights defender is a personal decision of a person. He makes the decision and he bears the responsibility for that decision. But to become a victim, you are not making any decision. But this is the fact you have to live with. And those people tend to be more brave and more courageous when they stand up and are ready to protect for their rights, to protect themselves, and we're just trying to help them. So actually, this award mainly goes to the victims of human rights violations. Thank you so much.
Well, I accept this award on behalf of 144 people who works in Novaya Gazeta, and who totally, every one of them, deserves this prize, because without them, even one of them, all work that we do, and now we're given a prize, is not possible. And that was, in some very strange way, recognized even by our enemy, and people who consider us as an enemy, and I mean Chechen authorities. When in April we published an article about the persecution Chechen gay in this small republic of Russia, Chechnya, Chechen authorities put together from 15 to 20,000 people, religious people, and announced a jihad to all staff of Novaya Gazeta, to all 144 people who worked there. And from one side, it was a kind of a threatening situation, but from the other side, it was a recognition that not one journalist, not two journalists, but all people in Novaya Gazeta as a team bringing these stories to people in Russia, to the world, and I consider it as a recognition also. I would prefer it wouldn't be happening, but still, if it's happening, it's a recognition. The whole team of Novaya Gazeta deserved all the prizes, this prize particularly, and I'm very proud to receive it on behalf of my people in my newspaper. But I'm also very proud to receive this prize together with Committee Against Torture, the brilliant, bravest, and very effective human rights organization in Russia, our friends. Also, I consider them as a team who work together with us in this region, Chechnya, which is very hard for work as a journalist there, as a human rights defender, and Committee Against Torture is a great example how dangerous it is, because they were beaten, their office was crushed 3 times in Chechnya, and everybody got punished with this. But still they continue together with us working on, for example, this story about the persecution of Chechen gay in Russia, in Chechnya. And I wish and I hope that next year the world would recognize and outline the role another human rights organization that helped a lot with this story, and without whom my work, the work of Novaya Gazeta, and probably the work of Committee Against Torture on this story wouldn't be possible. And I'm talking about the Russian LGBT network. They managed to save more than 100 people from Chechnya. We are together with Committee Against Torture, with Russian LGBT Network, Novaya Gazeta, trying to put those who detained people, tortured them, and even killed just because they have different sexual orientation. We're trying hard to bring those people and get them punished. Maybe it's not possible, but without working together, without working as a team, it wouldn't be possible, and it's still not, I mean, it's not possible at all. And the third thing that I want to say, that our work, human rights defenders, human rights activists, and journalists in Novaya Gazeta, and all other journalists that still exist in Russia, that are free, that professional, and we're not the only newspaper, independent newspaper in Russia. Few of us still there are. Their work wouldn't be possible without the great support from such organization like Norwegian Helsinki Committee. And with their great help, a lot of things already done, and with their help, a lot of things will be done in my country. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you all very much for being here with us today. The formal part of the event is over, and I would like to invite you all to some food and drinks out there in the foyer. Thank you.